What's up, guys? I'm Eric from Techisode TV, and this is the Surface Book 3. I've been waiting a long time for Microsoft to release this because for a while I've been using the Surface Book 2 for all of my on-the-go editing, and since I switched to 4K editing, it's not quite as smooth as I would like it to be. So I'm hoping the Surface Book 3 solves that issue. Obviously, since I have both of these devices, I'm gonna be doing some comparisons for you guys. Namely, we're gonna be taking a look at some unknown new features with the Surface Book 3, some things that a lot of people just aren't talking about, as well as some disappointments I have with the Surface Book 3, features that I wish were changed or added for the Surface Book 3, and they weren't. If you guys wanna see those videos, be sure to click the notification bell and turn notifications on, because if you don't, even if you're subscribed, you're not gonna be notified when those videos are uploaded, which kinda makes you wonder what the purpose to the subscribe button is in the first place. In this video, we're just gonna be doing an unboxing of the Surface Book 3, and I'm gonna be answering some common questions that people have with it. One of the most common questions is, how durable is that hinge? And I've got some pretty ridiculous life experiences with the Surface Book 2 over the past 2 years, where I forcibly separated the hinge from the base without pressing the disconnect button. I'll tell you guys that story and what happened in a little bit, but first, let's go ahead and get this thing unboxed and set up so we can start talking about it. This particular Surface Book is the 15-inch model. This one has the i7 processor with 1 terabyte of storage, 32 gigs of RAM, and of course the NVIDIA GTX 1660 Ti GPU with 6 gigs of VRAM. Microsoft does have a nice little pull tab here on the bottom. So if you pull this, then that will help you take this plastic off. Now we just lift up. And we have our Surface Book 3, nothing on the back side of this. We'll go ahead and take out the Surface Book 3, set that to the side. And in here we've got some paperwork, and this should be our power brick. The first thing I want to point out here is that the power brick is smaller with the Surface Book 3 than with the Surface Book 2, but it packs a lot more power. The Surface Book 3 gives you 127 watts of power with the charging brick, and the Surface Book 2 only came with 102 watts. Now, a lot of people were complaining about this power brick with the Surface Book 2 because if you were doing some really heavy gaming, then you'd actually be losing battery while you were gaming, even if you were plugged in, because this just wasn't enough power to keep your Surface Book 2 juiced up. Now, with a 127 watt adapter, not only will you be able to maintain power, but you'll also be able to charge while having heavy gaming sessions. Something else I noticed right away is that the power cord itself is considerably longer on the Surface Book 3 than the Surface Book 2. And I actually measured it out. It's 21 inches for the original cable and 41 inches for the new one. Now, this is actually pretty handy because there's been a few times where I've plugged in my adapter into the wall on the Surface Book 2, and this is barely long enough, so the adapter ends up kind of hanging a bit. So this extra length is gonna stop that from ever happening. Both adapters have a USB port for charging peripherals. The original adapter was only a 5-watt charger. The new one bumps it up to a 7-watt charger. In terms of weight, they feel almost exactly the same. Beneath this is nothing. It's just a box. So that's everything you get in the box. Let's go ahead and take a look at the laptop itself now. Let's go ahead and pull this off. She wraps all the way around to the inside. There we go. The first thing I want to point out about the Surface Book itself is that it is single finger opening. So it just takes one finger and the laptop will open. Now, when I first got a Surface Book, particularly the Surface Book 2, I didn't realize how big of a deal that was. I heard people talk about it and I was like, yeah, okay, you open it with one finger. But having gone back and used some laptops where you can't do that, it's actually an awesome feature to have. And I'm surprised at how many times I have one hand holding something and I'm trying to open my laptop and I'm doing one of these like holding it down with the palm of my hand, trying to like force things open, if it can't open with a single finger like the Surface Book line. In terms of hinge wobbleness, I'm just lightly tapping this here and you can see that it does wobble. This actually feels exactly the same as with my Surface Book 2. Now, this may look pretty bad on screen, but to be honest, when you're using this, either on your lap or on a table or whatever, if you're typing and stuff, this isn't wobbling at all. Even on your lap, it's not gonna wobble. Only when you're really trying to hit it with something, it's going to wobble. If you're walking with it, maybe it'll wobble a little bit. So don't be put off by this wobbliness. In actual use, and again, I've been using the Surface Book 2 for over 2 years, not once has that ever bothered me. In terms of durability for the hinge and kind of long-term usage, this is my Surface Book 2. Let's go ahead and open this with one finger. As you can see, that still opens with one finger perfectly fine, and the wobbliness is about the same. Oh my goodness, it's exactly the same actually. On my Surface Book 2 as with the Surface Book 3, and this is 2.5 years old. So really impressive that the hinge holds up that long. If Microsoft did nothing to change the hinge with the Surface Book 3, then I'd say they're in pretty good shape because again, here it is 2 years later, 2.5 years later, and it feels exactly the same as with the Surface Book 3. And even the amount of force it takes to close it, 100% identical. It's almost as if there has been zero wear in the hinge on the Surface Book 2. As you can tell just from the video, these two are 100% identical in terms of form factor. The ports are in the exact same places, the screen size is exactly the same, the resolution's exactly the same. If you didn't know what was on the inside of these two laptops, then there would be no way for you to tell that this is a Surface Book 3 over a Surface Book 2. Let me move the Surface Book 2 out of the way again, and we're gonna take a closer look at the Surface Book 3. Flipping over to the other side, you do see these two long rubber feet. This is exactly the same on the Surface Book 2. Flipping over to the side, you have your proprietary charging port and a USB-C port here as well. This is not a Thunderbolt port. Microsoft says that they've seen some security issues with Thunderbolt ports in general, and because of the security issues, they're intentionally not including them on any of their products. The significance of that is you can't use something like an external GPU with the Surface Book 3. But as I mentioned earlier, this one is outfitted with a GTX 1660 Ti GPU with 6 gigs of VRAM, so that's more than enough for the vast majority of people. If you're worried about data transfer rates with the Surface Book 3 and you're kind of concerned about not having Thunderbolt for that purpose, you really shouldn't be because these two ports on this side are USB 3.1 Gen 2, which means these support 10 gigabits per second, which is equivalent to 1.25 gigabytes per second. That is insanely fast, and unless you're transferring hundreds of gigs of data frequently, then this is not going to be a bottleneck for you. While we're on this side, we do maintain SD card support, and in case you're wondering, the SD card does not go all the way in. It also doesn't click in. It's not like it kind of clicks in and you have to click it back out. It just slides in and it does stick out a little bit. If I turn it this way, you can see how much that sticks out. Then you just pull it back out when you're done. As someone who edits a lot of footage on the go when I go to things like Samsung events, I find it invaluable to have this port here because it's one less thing I have to carry around with me when I'm traveling to events. Before I turn this on, there's one more thing I want to point out, and it's the fact that the headphone jack is up in this top corner right here. And that does get pretty annoying if you use wired headphones because the cord is going to droop down here. Sometimes it droops over your keyboard, sometimes it gets in the way of your mouse if you are right-handed, and it's just a placement that I'm really not a fan of. I would have loved to have seen this placed maybe down here on either side. That would have been preferable. But unfortunately, the way that this tablet connects to the base, there are 2 points right here in the corners that actually hold the tablet portion on, so there's really no space to put a headphone jack. However, I suppose Microsoft could have put a headphone jack somewhere in the side as a second option, so when you're docked, you have a headphone jack on the side, and when you're in tablet mode, you can use this headphone jack right here. Because when you're in tablet mode, this headphone jack is perfectly fine. I don't find that cumbersome in any way. Now, if you happen to own a really nice set of Bluetooth headphones with very low latency, then you will be able to watch movies or YouTube videos and have what someone is saying on the screen be in sync with what you're hearing in your headphones. The setup process for the Surface Book 3 is extremely easy. Just press the power button up in the corner and the laptop will start right up. While you're setting up your Surface Book 3, I do recommend putting in the power connector as well. As you can see, it is extremely easy to put that in. In case you're wondering, you can also charge the Surface Book 3 with the USB-C port as well, but you won't be able to charge as fast as with the power brick that comes with the Surface Book 3 and plugs into the proprietary connector.
Hi there, I'm Cortana, and I'm here to help.
So as you can see, you have the option to use Cortana, and it'll take you through 90% of the setup process just by using voice commands. So Cortana will ask you a question, you can say yes or no based on what Cortana is asking, and you can set up your entire laptop just with voice commands, which is pretty cool. You will still need to use a keyboard for some parts of the setup process, namely entering your password for your Wi-Fi network. If at any point you don't want to use Cortana, there's a little microphone icon on the bottom left of the screen. If you click that, Cortana won't talk to you anymore, and you can just click through the setup process. One thing I absolutely love about Windows 10 in general is how easy it is to set up, and just the voice interaction as well with Cortana makes it extremely simple that even someone who has zero experience with computers at all can set their own computer up. Now that the Surface Book 3 is set up, I want to detach the screen and show you guys something else. So I'm going to just press that button, the screen detaches, pop that off. Now if we flip over to the bottom, you're going to see that there's one extra port right here. Now this is the same proprietary connector as the charging port. I can go ahead and drop this on right here and start charging the tablet portion of my Surface Book 3. The reason I'm showing you this is because I want to point out something very important, and it's the fact that this can only be used for charging your Surface Book 3, at least at the time of making this video. I've seen people with the Surface Book 2 try to get some sort of connector in here, some sort of adapter that allows them to connect a USB stick or a USB drive to just the tablet portion of their Surface Book 2, and I haven't seen anything work reliably. So if you wanted to use just the tablet portion and you wanted to connect an external hard drive, maybe you want to go through some photos or sort some data or watch some videos or something like that that's on an external drive, and you just want to use the tablet portion, you don't want to use the base, that is not something you'll be able to do. You'll first have to transfer all of that data from the USB stick to the internal hard drive in the Surface Book 3. Then you can detach the tablet and look at those photos and videos like that. Also, these two USB-C looking ports right here aren't actually ports at all. This is actually the mechanism for how the tablet attaches back to the base. And these ports on the side are high-speed data ports that are used for the GPU connection. One more thing I want to point out is that if you're wondering where the speakers are on the Surface Book 3, it's actually on the tablet portion, and these tiny little slits right here, these tiny little slits right here, there's one on either side, these are the speakers for the Surface Book 3. Now they may look extremely tiny, but they actually get decently loud. Here's a quick sample of the audio from a recent video I did on the iPhone SE.
If you wanted to see the unknown camera features video, you can click the link at the end of this video or the link in the description. Also, while I'm focusing this video on the iPhone SE.
So I don't know if you guys can tell how loud this is getting from the camera, but it's much louder than I'd actually set the volume if I'm just listening to it at a desk or sitting on a couch. The other thing I noticed is that it doesn't get tinny or crackly at the max volume. And in case you're wondering, the volume buttons are at the top, right next to the power button. Having this video on the screen brings up another important thing that I wanted to talk about, and it's the aspect ratio. As you can tell, this is not your standard 16:9 aspect ratio that you see on a lot of different laptops. What that means is when you're watching videos, you do have unused screen real estate on the bottom and on the top. So if you're looking to get this specifically for media consumption, watching a lot of movies and things like that, then I don't know that this is going to be the best bet for that, because you are going to have unused screen real estate. If you're using this mainly to get work done in different types of programs, then this taller aspect ratio actually works out really well, even for things like web browsing, but particularly for things like Premiere Pro, because it allows you to have more visible layers in your timeline. And just in case you're really not familiar with the Surface Book line of laptops, you can actually install this backwards. So I'm going to go ahead and install this back on the other way and fold that back down like this. What this will do is give you a lot of extra battery life because you have the battery that's in the base as well, but it also gives you access to the power of the GPU while using it in tablet mode. And in case you're wondering, the keyboard does not work in this mode, neither does the trackpad, so you don't need to worry about accidentally hitting any keys or moving the trackpad when you flip things over. And if you want to switch things back, you can either open it all the way back up and push the eject button again, or you can tap this eject button right here. You'll hear that little pop sound. It'll tell you that it's ready to detach. You can just pick it up a little bit, pull it out, flip it around, and pop it right back on. There are three notable accessories for the Surface Book 3. The first of which is a Surface Pen. This is an inductive stylus that you can use to either draw pictures or you can write with it. And if you flip it over and use the back, you can also erase with it. There's also two buttons on it. You have this side button here. And if you click and tap with this, it acts as a right click. And the back has a bunch of different functions. So if you click it once, that has one function. In my case, it opens Whiteboard, which is another drawing application. If you click it twice, then it will actually take a screenshot and then let you draw on that screenshot. And if you long press it, then it will open up a sticky note that you can write on. Now, these are customizable. So if you go into the pen settings, you can see that a click once, currently I have it set to open up Microsoft Whiteboard, but you can do screen snipping, you can do Windows Ink Workspace, open up OneNote, or you can launch any specific app that you'd like to open, or you can open up OneNote 2016. Double click, again, you get a bunch of different options for double click. There's two sets of options there. And then pressing and holding, you get those options as well. And actually, this is an important one to point out here, Cortana. So if you use Cortana a lot, then long pressing the pen can just bring up Cortana instead if you'd like. I'd also like to point out that the pen tip does feel really natural to use, and the eraser surprisingly feels like a real eraser. Whatever kind of rubber they use for this does make it feel like you're actually using a real eraser, which is pretty neat. The last thing I need to point out about the pen is that it sticks magnetically to the side of your Surface Book 3, and you can put it on in any orientation. It also holds on really securely. You can see I'm hitting that pretty hard, and it's just staying right on there. But when you need to get it off, it pops off easy enough. And obviously it does work on either side of the screen. The second notable accessory is the Surface Dial. Now, this is a dial that has haptic feedback, so as you rotate it, you do feel a bit of vibration, and it does a bunch of different things depending on the application you're in. So in this particular application, this is Paint 3D, I currently have it set to change the color of the pen as I rotate the wheel. And as you can see, the pen color is changing while I'm drawing. But if you long press it, then you get a few other options, and I can rotate the wheel and choose something else like thickness, click the button again, and now as I draw, you can see that I can change the thickness real time as I draw. So again, this is obviously a tool that's great for artists or any sort of graphic designer. If I long press it again, you can see that I get another option for history, which allows me to go back and forward through the different things that I just did. The Surface Dial also has customizable commands that can be customized based on specific applications. So if you're in Premiere Pro editing some videos, you can have custom commands for maybe a click is making a cut, and then turning left and right is jogging forward and backwards through the timeline or switching layers. Whatever you want, it's really, really customizable. You can even do things like change your screen brightness, increase, decrease volume, rotate things, lots and lots of different things you can do with the Surface Dial. And depending on the application, you can even put the Surface Dial on the screen and you'll get certain things that pop up around the Surface Dial. So it doesn't work in this particular application, but in some applications, if you're drawing with colors and then you click the Surface Dial, you'll actually get this ring that pops up around it with all the different colors. So as you rotate the dial, you'll be able to see the different color that's being selected around the dial. Another thing you could do is use it as a protractor, and the lines actually show up based on where you place the Surface Dial on the screen. So again, depending on the application, you're gonna get a lot of different on-screen features with the Surface Dial as well. The bottom of the Surface Dial has this sort of sticky pad on it, and when you place it on the screen, it doesn't really slide around that much at all. So much so that if I actually turn this around and raise the screen up, you can see that I can actually just place it on the screen and it'll stay on there pretty well. Now it will start to slide down a little bit if I let go. You'll see that it does slide down at an angle, but most of the time you're gonna have this on the screen is going to be down like this and it's just gonna stay on the screen perfectly fine. The last notable accessory is the Surface Dock. This is what you'd get if you want to connect your Surface Book 3 to multiple external monitors, maybe an external keyboard, and basically use this as a desktop replacement as well. Now, this is the previous version of the Surface Dock. The new one swaps out these standard USB ports with USB-C ports that are USB 3.2 and support 15-watt charging, so you can charge smartphones or other peripherals quickly. And if you flip it over to the back, these two ports are swapped out with USB-C ports that are going to be used for your display ports. And the new ports support 4K at 60 hertz for two monitors, plus this display as well. Or you can have two external 5K monitors at 30 hertz, plus the Surface Book 3 display as well, which is a substantial increase from the previous generation, which was only 4K at 30 hertz for two monitors. The new dock does maintain two standard size USB ports on the back. It also maintains this audio jack, a gigabit Ethernet port, and obviously this is the power adapter to bring power to the dock itself. And turning it over to this side, you get a port for a Kensington lock. And just in case you guys were hoping to just get the base to get the more powerful GPU and keep your Surface Book 2 tablet portion, that does not work, as I'll demonstrate here right now. I'll pull off my Surface Book 3, and I'll put on my Surface Book 2 and we'll see what happens. Look at that. So what's happening right now is these magnets are a different polarity than on the Surface Book 2. So this is actually going to push my Surface Book 2 away from it. Right now I'm trying to push it on and the magnets are just not letting me. Even if you try to kind of forcibly get it on here like that, yeah, it still doesn't like it. Nothing happens. It doesn't acknowledge anything. One more thing I noticed when I went to plug in my Surface Book 3 is that the new power adapter, while one side is longer, the other side is actually shorter. And when you stretch them all the way out, the new one is only about 6 inches longer than the old one. Not a big deal, but I figured I'd point it out. Now let's talk about the durability of the hinge. Now, a lot of people are concerned that since there is a gap here, that if you push down on this part of the screen hard enough, that this is going to either break those little arms that stick out, it's gonna break the bottom of the tablet portion, or it's just gonna snap the tablet portion right in the middle. But that is not the case. So in one instance, I had my Surface Book 2 in a backpack where there's a dedicated sleeve that's closest to your back, and I had a bunch of camera gear in the backpack as well. So it was stuffed really, really tight in that bag. And when I bent over to pick something up with the bag on my back, it put a ton of force right here in the center. And I kid you not, I bent down to pick something up at the airport and I heard a snap. And I thought to myself, oh my goodness, I just broke my insanely expensive laptop in my bag that I need for the Samsung event that I'm going to. And so I go ahead, I take it out of the bag, expecting to see a shattered screen, broken pieces all over the place, and I didn't see any of that. Instead, what I saw was just the tablet separated from the base. And then I thought to myself, okay, well, I bet I'm not gonna be able to put this back on. I bet I broke the mechanism that holds this in place. So I turned the laptop on, and I went to go mount it back on the base, and it just mounted back on like nothing had ever happened. So that was my first instance where I was like, wow, this thing is crazy strong. It takes so much force that it separates it just by pressure, putting pressure here hard like this, it just separated and nothing broke. It then happened a second time on the same trip, even though I was trying to be careful. And what I learned from that is instead of having it in a bag like this, I now separate the two pieces and I lay them flush on each other instead of on the hinge, so there's no gap like this. Then I put it in the bag and I haven't had any issues since. That said, this does still count as kind of a downside for the Surface Book line in general. And it's that if you do travel a lot with it and you tend to really pack your bags really tight so that there's a lot of force on your laptop when you slide it in, then there is the risk of the tablet portion popping off. But again, I've done it twice and haven't had anything break, but that is something you guys should know about. The last testament to the durability of this hinge is that I had my Surface Book 2 laying on the ground next to my desk right here when I was working on something else on my desktop, and my 40-pound-year-old toddler comes in, and I kid you not, he stands 1 foot here, 1 foot here, all 40 pounds. And again, in that moment, I thought, oh my goodness, this thing is gonna break into pieces. And it didn't. I didn't hear any cracks, no flexes, no nothing. He just stood all 40 pounds right here and nothing happened. So the point to these stories is that if you are in any way concerned about this hinge and the durability, don't be. My Surface Book 2 has been through the ringer with the hinge and everything still works flawlessly. You guys saw earlier in the video, it still opens with one finger. The wobble is exactly the same as the new one. And I have not noticed any differences or degradation in the hinge over the past 2.5 years, especially with those few instances of either forcibly removing the hinge or my toddler standing on this hinge. So I hope you guys found this video helpful. If you did, go ahead and drop a like down below and don't forget to click the notification bell so you can see all of my other Surface Book 3 coverage. And if you guys have any specific questions about it, definitely let me know in the comments or on Twitter at TechisodeTV, and I'll try to answer as many of your questions in my upcoming videos. That's it for this Techisode. God bless, guys, and I'll catch you in the next one.